Snow White. Long ago and far away, in the days when witches and fairies roamed the earth and the countryside was covered in thick dark forests, there lived a king and a queen and a princess. The king was rich and the queen was beautiful and the princess was good and lovely, and one might have thought that all three would have been happy and contented, but they were not. You see, the queen was the king's second wife. She was not the mother of the lovely little princess, and the more the king loved his daughter, the princess, the more the queen hated her. The queen was jealous. If the princess practiced playing the harp, the queen would snap, "Can't that wretched girl ever be quiet? My head is splitting with the noise of that terrible twanging. How she can call it music, I don't know." And if the princess played with one of the royal dogs, the queen would order her to turn the dog out into the yard, where it belonged, or so the queen said. The queen was jealous even if the dog loved the princess. Of course, all this bad temper upset the king and, for the sake of keeping peace with the queen, he tried not to show too much love for Snow White. Snow White. That was the name of the lovely little princess. What a very unusual name that was. It had been a very bitter winter, the year Snow White had been born, and as her mother, the first queen, had been sewing baby clothes, she had accidentally pricked her finger and a drop of blood had fallen onto the white snow. "That is how I should like my baby to be," smiled the queen, with a skin as white as the snow, lips as red as blood, and her hair as black as the ebony wood of this windowsill. So as those were magical times and as the queen was a very important lady, her wish was granted, and when her baby girl was born in the springtime, her skin was as white as snow, her lips as red as blood, and her hair as black as ebony. How happy the queen was! "We will call the little girl Snow White," she smiled, and so it was. But happy days are all too short. Snow White's mother died and the king married again. The new queen's face was beautiful, but her heart was black with evil and her eyes were green with jealousy. In fact, many things were strange about the beautiful new queen, not the least being that hidden behind the curtain in her private room she kept a talking mirror. If the queen gazed into the secret glowing depths of the mirror, she saw not her own reflection, but a swirling, shimmering face, which spoke only the truth. Every day the queen would gaze into the mirror and ask, "Mirror on the wall, who is the fairest one of all?" And for the years the mirror had answered, "Lovely lady, slim and tall, you are the fairest one of all." But the day came when the mirror gave an answer which the queen did not wish to hear. "As I hang upon this wall, Snow White is the fairest one of all," chanted the mirror. The queen was furious. But she knew the mirror always spoke the truth. Snow White was the fairest. The queen's green eyes burned with jealous hatred. She drew the curtain across the magic mirror, walked from her room and stared coldly at Snow White laughing happily with her father. The love in the king's face as he smiled at Snow White sealed his pretty, young daughter's fate. Secretly, the wicked queen sent for a royal huntsman. She sat smiling at him in the rose garden, clinking a handful of thick golden coins between her fingers. "That Snow White is a troublemaker," said the queen. "She is turning the king against me. She must go. How grateful I should be to the man who would take Snow White deep into the forest and kill her." The huntsman's blood chilled with horror at those wicked words, but his eyes noticed how the gold coins gleamed richly in the sunlight. The queen turned her heartless gaze full on the shivering huntsman. "I would give this gold to the man who would bring me Snow White's heart to prove she was dead," murmured the queen, "but to a man who refused my request, I would be very ungrateful." The next day the huntsman took Snow White deep into the dark forest which covered the land all round the little kingdom. How Snow White enjoyed the trip into the forest, and as the huntsman looked at her pretty, young face, he could not bring himself to kill her. However, his feelings were not so kindly that he did not still want the gold. He told Snow White of the wicked queen's plot. "Run away into the forest and never come back, and I will tell the queen you are dead," advised the huntsman. Snow White was terrified. She ran and ran, trying to get as far as she could from the hatred of the wicked queen. And the huntsman slew a deer and took its heart to the queen, and she thought it was the heart of Snow White. Now the dark forest is a frightening place, and the Snow White gasped with joy when she saw a pretty little cottage, a very little cottage actually. She knocked at the door, but no one answered. Then, as it was cold and night was falling, Snow White pushed open the door of the cottage and went inside. There was no one at home, but the place was cozy and welcoming, and the table was laid for supper for 7 people. "Perhaps I could eat a mouthful or two, though, Snow White. I am so hungry." So she ate a little of everything in hope that no one would notice that some of the food was missing. Then, tired out by all the horrid things that had happened to her, weary Snow White stumbled across to one of the 7 beds, which were also in the cottage, and fell into a deep, exhausted sleep. How lucky for Snow White that she had found the cottage just as dusk was falling, but she was even luckier than she knew. The cottage belonged to 7 kindly little men who would shelter Snow White in her time of danger. However, the little men knew nothing of all this yet. They were dwarfs and they were also miners. Every day they went to dig for gold and jewels in the nearby mountains. And every evening they trotted home thinking how nice supper was going to taste and how good it would be to have a restful evening in their cozy little cottage home. The cottage only needed to be little, you see, because the dwarfs were such little folk. But no doubt you have heard the old saying, there is many a slip betwixt cup and lip. And of course, when the hungry dwarfs arrived home, they noticed at once that someone had been nibbling at their supper. And then, as Snow White was so much bigger than they were, they couldn't help noticing that she was lying on one of the beds. "And where have you come from, young lady?" they asked in quite a friendly way. Snow White woke with a start. Meanwhile, at the palace, the queen was so sure that Snow White was dead that for days and weeks she did not bother to ask her magic mirror who was the fairest in the land, but one day, at last, she did. "Mirror, mirror on the wall, who is the fairest of all?" She smiled, quite sure that she knew the answer and that the answer would be what she wanted to hear. But the mirror glowed brightly and truth shimmered from its depths. "Far away o'er fen and glen, Snow White dwells with little men. And though your grace is slim and tall, Snow White is the fairest one of all." The queen turned away with rage burning in her wicked, black heart. "So the huntsman lied and Snow White is alive," she murmured. Then she smiled her thin, cruel smile. "But not for long," she added. Now, in all those weeks when the queen had not bothered to question her magic mirror, Snow White had been living happy and safe in the cottage belonging to the 7 dwarfs. While the dwarfs worked in their mine, Snow White looked after the pretty cottage, but the dwarfs were always anxious for her safety. "We know the queen, your stepmother, of old," they said. "She is not only wicked, but clever with it. She will try to harm you again. Be very careful of any stranger. But it is rather dreary shut up alone doing housework all day long." And when one day an old peasant woman knocked at the cottage door selling pretty combs, Snow White bought one. What a terrible mistake, because of course the peasant woman was the queen in disguise, and the comb was poisoned. Ah, poor Snow White. The trusting little princess had no sooner run the comb through her beautiful ebony black hair than the poison seized her in its grip and she fell down as if dead. How the old peasant woman laughed. "Well, you are no longer the fairest in the land now, Snow White," she sneered. "The magic mirror will return me a better answer when I speak to it tonight." And off she ran, just as the 7 dwarfs came trudging home from their work in the mine. "I wonder what Snow White has cooked for our supper tonight," the dwarfs were saying to each other. And they had just made up their minds that they hoped supper would be stew with dumplings, when they caught sight of the old peasant woman hurrying away from their cottage. "Who is that?" they gasped. "It is no one who lives round here. It can't be. No one else does live round here." Then they thought of Snow White alone in the cottage and they were afraid. Could the peasant woman have been the queen in disguise? The dwarfs ran home dreading to think of what they would find. And oh, their worst fears were true. Snow White lay on a bed as dead. It seemed that the wicked queen had won. "Oh, Snow White, Snow White, come back to us," sobbed the heartbroken dwarfs, shaking poor Snow White, and as they did so, the poison comb fell from Snow White's ebony black hair and the poison lost its power and Snow White came back to life. The dwarfs were so happy, but they were still scared. "Beware of strangers," they warned. "The wicked queen will strike again." How right the dwarfs were. The wicked queen ran home full of happiness because Snow White was dead. "Now I am the most beautiful lady in the land," sighed the queen, happily pulling the curtain back from the magic mirror, because although the queen knew she was so beautiful, she still wanted to hear someone else say so. Of course, by now the queen had taken off her disguise as a peasant woman and she was again her grand and lovely self. "Mirror, mirror on the wall, who is the fairest of all?" chanted the queen, almost singing in her happiness to think that once again she herself would be the most beautiful lady in the kingdom. Imagine her rage and disbelief when the mirror replied, "Lovely queen, thou art so fair. But Snow White living o'er the fen, with the seven little men, has a beauty far more rare." Then the queen knew that she had failed and that Snow White still lived and she raged and stormed in her anger. "That wretched little brat with her white face and her red lips and her black hair. Shall I never be rid of her?" screamed the queen. But then the queen calmed down and another plot formed in her cunning brain. She sat amongst her bottles and jars and magic potions and made an apple, rosy on one side and green on the other. The apple was so pretty and crunchy looking that no one would see it and not wish to bite it. But the apple was poisoned. Then once more the queen disguised herself and set off to call at the cottage belonging to the seven dwarfs. As before, the queen waited until the dwarfs were far away working in their mine. And as before, Snow White was by herself in the lonely cottage. Well, one might have thought that after the fright with the comb Snow White would have kept the doors barred against strangers, but young heads are thoughtless and lonely hours drag by wearily and Snow White had done the same housework so many times over that it was just no fun anymore. When the friendly old lady came knocking at the door, Snow White was glad to have someone to talk to. "You are such a pretty little girl, I should like to give you this apple as a present," smiled the old lady, who was really the queen. Snow White felt a little doubtful. "You are so kind and the apple is so rosy," smiled Snow White, "but I don't think I should eat it till the dwarfs get home and say that I may." The queen was furious, but she hid her anger with a smile. "But the apple is harmless, my dear," she whined. "Look, I will eat some myself." And she took a bite from the green side, which held no poison. Of course, when Snow White saw the old lady eating the apple and no harm coming to her, she felt that the apple was safe and that her fears were silly. She took the apple indoors and bit into the lovely rosy side. Ah, poor, young foolish Snow White. She should have remembered the dwarf's warning. As she tried to swallow the bite of rosy apple, it stuck in her throat and Snow White fell dead to the floor. The wicked queen watching through the cottage window laughed with joy. And when she had taken off her disguise, indeed she was. The queen returned to her royal palace and lived in happiness through the long summer days, not caring one jot for the misery she had brought to so many other people. And the seven dwarfs trotted home from their mine not knowing that they would find their beloved Snow White dead. Or at least, so it seemed. "Snow White, Snow White, we're home," called the dwarfs, as they trotted back as usual from the mine. "I hope she has made that meat pie she promised," puffed one of the dwarfs. "And that she has made lots of thick gravy to go with it," added another. "I can't stand thin gravy." But as they approached the cottage, the dwarfs began to feel uneasy. No nice smell of baking pie drifted across the clearing and no steam from the bubbling gravy, thick or thin, curled through the kitchen window. And worst of all, Snow White was not standing in the cottage doorway as usual, eagerly looking for their return home. The dwarfs ran into the cottage and saw what they knew they would see. Snow White lay dead. She had gone away. They were left alone. Now they had only their unhappiness. The wicked queen had won. How cruel the ways of the world did seem. But of course all this happiness way back in the days of magic and things weren't really as bad as they appeared. To start with, although Snow White neither breathed, nor spoke, nor moved, somehow she didn't seem to be dead. The color still stayed in her blood-red lips and her black ebony hair stayed as glossy and beautiful as ever. It just did not seem right to bury anything so lovely in the cold dark ground. So the dwarfs made a coffin of crystal clear glass and rested Snow White inside it where every day they could see her unfading loveliness. The dwarfs put the coffin on the mountainside near their mine and every day they stood beside it and remembered the happy days when Snow White had been alive. The one day a handsome prince came riding through the mountain passes on his fine white horse. How surprised he was when he looked across a rocky valley and saw seven little men grouped around a crystal coffin. The prince was even more surprised when he rode closer and saw that inside the coffin was a beautiful girl with skin as white as snow, lips as red as blood, arid hair as black as ebony. The prince had never seen anyone more lovely in all his life and at once he fell in love with Snow White. How hopeless for the poor prince to love a dead girl, but remember, those were magic days. Please let me take the coffin back to my palace where it can rest in a fine room and be far safer than out here in all weathers on this rugged mountainside, begged the prince. The dwarfs weren't at all pleased with that suggestion. We want to keep Snow White here where we can look after her, they explained. But then they remembered that they weren't getting any younger and the day might come when they no longer had the strength to climb the steep mountainside and brush the dead leaves or the drifted snow from the crystal that sheltered their beloved Snow White. Fate sent the prince to help us, they decided. And they were right. If the prince had not clattered past on his fine horse, Snow White might have lain still on the mountainside for many a long year, but because of the prince, the seven dwarfs picked up the crystal coffin and moved it. We will carry Snow White down from the mountains and take her safely to your palace, they said to the prince. But the little chaps were in such a dither at moving the crystal coffin after so long and they were handling it so very carefully so that it would not fall that, of course, they did drop it. And then, how wonderful! The bump of the coffin landing on the ground jerked the piece of rosy apple from Snow White's throat and she breathed again and sat up alive and well. How puzzled she was to find herself out on the mountainside and to see the dwarfs looking so surprised and pleased. The wicked queen gave you a poisoned apple and you have lain as dead for many a long year, explained the dwarfs, but now you are alive again, dear Snow White. Then Snow White turned her eyes to see the handsome prince and they smiled at each other and they knew that they were in love. Will you make me the happiest man in the world by marrying me and coming to live in my palace? Asked the prince. Indeed I will, replied Snow White, because although she didn't know the prince very well, she could remember that palaces were very nice places, with servants to do all the work and it had been getting rather lonely in the dwarf's cottage by herself all day long. And although the dwarfs were sorry to lose Snow White again so soon, they knew it was only right that a pretty princess should marry a handsome prince, so they picked flowers for joy and went with Snow White and the prince down to his palace to join in all the wedding feasting. After all, Snow White explained to them, now I am the mistress of a fine palace. You will always have somewhere to stay when you need a holiday or when you are too old to work. So the dwarfs felt very pleased and had no more worries for the rest of their lives. Three cheers for Snow White and her prince, they laughed. But there was one person who was not pleased by this happy turn of events, and I'm sure you can guess who it was. The wicked queen. One evening, as usual, The queen gazed happily into her magic mirror, and just so that she could hear yet again how beautiful she was, she asked, "Mirror, mirror on the wall, who is the fairest one of all?" How astounded she was when the mirror replied, "Lady, lady startling there, than thee there is a bride mare fair." The queen was furious. "So there is a bride more fair than I am, is there?" she hissed. "Well, as I said about Snow White, not for long. I will soon put this new bride out of the way, just as I did that brat of a girl." Then the queen picked up a heavy candlestick and stepped towards the mirror. "And I've had enough of your giving the wrong answers, too," she snapped. "There is such a thing as saying the right thing at the wrong time, you know, and you have done it once too often." The queen smashed the mirror to pieces. How ungrateful. But the queen was like that. Then the wretched jealous queen raced through the land until she found the bride about whom the mirror had spoken, and, of course, the bride was Snow White. But this time the dwarfs were ready. They tricked the queen into putting on a pair of magic shoes which danced her into the far distance and kept the queen from ever coming near Snow White again. So Snow White and the prince lived happily ever after. The end.